Hello everyone, and Merry Christmas. Today is a Jimmy Driftwood Christmas card special, Folk Music Rewind, with Leland Whirl playing some old Christmas tunes and talking about them. And then at 5 o'clock, Alex Prince and Dwayne Porterfield, minus Grisham on the bass, today will be performing Christmas tunes, and we're just going to have a great time with them. And thank you for listening to Folk Music Rewind, the Jimmy Driftwood Christmas special. Let's go ahead and rewind.
This song is called Asolin, A-S-O-L-I-N, Asolin. And it was written by Paul Stuckey and Tracy Batiste and Elena Mezetti. I'm sorry, M-E-Z-Z-E-T-T-I.
Do you know what the bands they were in?
No, I don't.
Oh,
well, Peter, Paul, and Mary, but I don't know who these other... Tracy, I've seen that name before, Tracy.
I have stuff signed by her.
B-A-T-T.
I have stuff signed
E-A-S-T.
By a couple of albums by different people that,
like... I got...
That are from New York.
Uh-huh.
And they're signed, but I'll have to show them to you.
I got Peter's autograph. I met Peter and Paul after the concert. They all split up and people
they
come.
You, though, right? You guys are good friends.
No, they didn't know me. I wish. I mean, I loved their stuff. But each of them would go to a different area, and the audience could come around after the concert was over, mm-hmm. and they would just sit and talk and, you know, ask questions, answer questions, whatever. It was kind of nice. But then I went to Peter's. I went to Paul's, and I was in Constitution Hall in Washington, D.C. In Washington, D.C., I was in a neighborhood that gets a little rough after dark when the streetlights go off especially. Well, I must have missed my taxi or whatever it was. And so finally, I was sitting there getting a little nervous because I'm in the military. I'm in a uniform, of course. And no, maybe I wasn't at the time. Anyway, no, I wasn't in a uniform. But anyway, with white sidewalls, your hair, you know, it kind of shows up. Anyway, I was sitting there, and finally, you know, on the street, street lights are on. Nobody's on the street anymore. And I'm getting a little nervous because I'm not supposed to be in this neighborhood anymore. And a taxi pulled up, and I said, oh, good. You know, I'm glad you got my call. And I started getting in the taxi. And right when I was getting in, I saw two people about the end of the block away from me, and they said, hold that taxi. And the taxi driver was also nervous because he knew the neighborhood was not one you want to be in after dark. And he said, come on, just get in, let's go. I said, but these people need a ride, and I wouldn't want to be left behind myself either. And as they got closer, I thought, he's carrying something. Oh, he's carrying a guitar case. They get closer and closer, and it's Peter and his wife, Mary. The guy said, get in the car, let's go. The taxi driver. And I said, no, he said, they're not going wherever you're going. I said, it doesn't matter where they're going. I'll pay, take them wherever they want to go, and I'll pay from there back, you know, no big deal. And, we got in the taxi and we talked a little bit, and I'd written a song I wanted to give them, kind of an avant-garde song that I don't remember anymore hardly, but I thought it was kind of interesting, something they would really love. And Peter gave me his phone number and address and said, come to New York. Come see me. Come spend the weekend. And I thought, oh, yeah, you can count on that. I'm coming. But it wasn't a good time for him because several years before they went overseas, a couple of young groupie girls that were minors jumped in on him. He was at his room. He had just taken a shower, and he'd called for room service, and they were supposed to be bringing food up. And when he opened the door, thinking it was room service, it was his two minors, and they came in. He's in a towel, and a lawyer kind of got a hold of that and said, wait a minute. Statute of limitations is 7 years. This is just 5 years ago. We can sue Peter, Paul, and Mary, and they've got a lot of money. We're going to make a killing, you know. So it was one of those deals. And that came out in the headlines the weekend I was going up to spend the weekend with him. I thought, he doesn't need company right now. So I went to New York, but I didn't go see him then. I had a good friend. Well, my sister's old roommate worked for Cosmo. They called it Cosmopolitan magazine. She and her roommates worked for Cosmopolitan. And she said, I'll get you a date and we'll go to a Broadway play. I said, I'd like to go to a play, but I don't want a date because, for one thing, I was a skinhead. And I had gone to the base exchange or whatever you want to call it and bought some clothes. And I looked like a pimp. I mean, I really did. Yeah, I thought I looked pretty cool. But I had powder blue shoes and I had some purple bell bottoms with a maroon stripe in them. And then I had a hot pink shirt with those barrel cuffs and blue stripes on it and a white double-breasted belted coat and an Indian tie, a tie from India with day-glow oranges and everything. You know, nothing matched, but, you know, again, I looked like a pimp, and I knew that. But anyway, so she got me a date anyway. And I said, man, you know, first place, I'm a low-ranked guy. I'm a specialist, spec 4. That's like a corporal, except I was a specialist, which, you know, a professional grade of it. They told me I was a computer programmer analyst, and I thought, okay. Anyway, that she got me a date with Pia Zadora, and I didn't know who she was. But Pia really went with us because she wanted to date the guy that my friend was dating. He was like a multi-millionaire. And we were triple dating. And there was another couple, and they were millionaires too. So I made $2,276 a year. So, I mean, hey, we're going to have fun, you know. So I meet Pia, and that's another story. I won't go into all of it, but it was an interesting evening. I'll say it that way. She was still living with her parents. Well, I will say this part about it. I caught a subway and went as close as I could find. And I got off the wrong place and I had to walk a few blocks across another area. Finally found the apartment complex where she lived with her parents. And when I walked in, her parents were famous Broadway actors. They did Hello, Dolly, the original. Her mother and father both did that. Anyway, when I knocked on the door, I come in, and her dad's standing there in his sock feet and what they used to call, an undershirt, not a T-shirt, wife beaters, some people in the South call them. You know, he's standing there like that, and I step in. He said, Pia's busy right now. He said, come on in. He said, stop right there. And I thought, uh-oh, he's going to make fun of the way I'm dressed. He said, Turn around, turn sideways, turn back this way. Of course, I had just got out of basic training, so I had a good tan. But he said, have you ever been on stage? I said, no. I mean, it's my first time in New York. Anyway, he said, man, you've got cheekbones, and your complexion is just great. And you need to be on the stage. And I thought, okay, fine, you know. I mean, I don't know if he's putting me on or what. Pia walks in the door, and she's about 4 foot tall, real short thing, wearing a little mini dress, top and bottom, you know, little black dress, and with a pink feather boa thrown around. And she steps out like, hey, what do you think? I'm like, I don't know what I think. I mean, I'm kind of shocked. But she said, Dad, leave him alone. Come on, let's go out of here. And so we get on the elevator, and she starts bragging about the building. This is a great place to live because all the Broadway producers and directors live here, and this is, you know, wonderful. I thought, okay, good. You know, oh, and she said, how did you get here? I said, well, I got off on such and such, and I walked over, you know, about three blocks, whatever it was, three or four blocks, which wasn't a big deal. And she said, oh, no, you came on so-and-so street? And I said, yeah, that's where it let me off. He said, I've never been on that street in my life. You're lucky to be alive. I can't believe you walked through that those streets. And I thought, well, I guess nobody messed with me because I look like a pimp. They're like, this guy's crazy too, you know. Anyway, so we get off the elevator, step out the front, and a taxi driver screeches up, halt, and honks and hollers, "Pia, let's see what you got." And she strikes a pose and throws her little feather boa out. Like, I'm going like, what kind of evening is this going to be? So she took us, we went to see Company. And it was before it was released, because having been a Broadway actress herself, it was just for the professionals to, you know, drive around, I guess. And she talked all through the whole time. And we went out to dinner, and I'm thinking, well, I don't know. We went to an Italian restaurant, and I thought, hey, I'm going to be cool about this. You're Italian. You order. And she looked at me with a really mean face. She said, I'm not Italian. And I thought, well, I don't know what you are. It's a Greek word. I know now it's Greek. But, I figured it was Italian. And I said, well, never mind. I can order. But the menu was all in Italian. And it folded out about 4 or 5 pages and tall. They were like 14 inches tall. Anyway, so I went ahead and ordered for us. I said, we want this and this and this. And we did fine. And then after, during the evening then, she's saying, let's dump these two guys. She didn't want to be with them. She was irritated because she wanted to actually be dating one of the millionaire guys. And she said, let's just dump them. I said, fine. She said, let's just pick up some cookies and some snacks and go back and watch a movie with my dad. And I said, okay. Anyway, we tell them we're going to this arcade. We want to do the arcade. Y'all go ahead. You know, they're going to go out drinking and stuff, and I don't drink anyway. So I said, okay. I thought that was a good idea because I didn't have a lot of money. I had almost none. Anyway, we're walking down the street, and she looks up, and there's this old drunk-looking guy walking a little poodle, a little mini dog on a leash, and he's staggering back and forth on the curb, back and forth, and he's grubby-looking and acting, and she walks. She said, look at that. Isn't that just disgusting? Don't you hate to see something like this? And she walked up to him, started pushing. She was telling me, what do you think about this, you know? And I'm like, hey, I don't know the guy. Anyway, she started pushing him. Oh, man, you're disgusting. I can't believe you. You know, you shouldn't be a drunk, you know. And he's just going on. And I'm getting really embarrassed, thinking, come on, leave him alone. You know, let's go on. He's drunk. He didn't know what we're doing. And she stepped back and looked at me and kind of smiled. She said, you don't know? I said, know what? It was her dad. He was totally acting. Oh, I did not know it was him because he was in character. Oh, and I thought, okay. So anyway, I just took her back to her apartment and left. You know, I thought, she's weird. They're weird. But we did write some. We wrote letters back and forth for a while because she was with a Good Time Opera Company up in New England State somewhere. And so I wrote her a couple times. I think she wrote me back. But later I used to see her on, she was on Paint Your Wagon or something like that, some movie. And then she started singing classical tunes on Johnny Carson and stuff. She married some old rich guy that was a, you know, 89-year-old billionaire. And she had a kid.
She got a billionaire.
Yeah. And, well, it's a good thing she stayed away from me because that wouldn't have happened. Anyway, sorry for all that delay. Now, where am I? Okay. This song is called Asolin, A-S-O-L-I-N, Asolin. This song is called Asolin, A-S-O-L-I-N, Asolin. And it was written by Paul Stuckey and Tracy Batiste and Elena Mezetti. I'm sorry, M-E-Z-Z-E-T-T-I. Thank you.
Hey-ho, nobody home. Meat nor drink nor money have I none. Yet shall we be merry. Hey-ho, nobody home. God bless the master of this house, Mr. Isalt's soul, and all the little children round your table grow. The cattle in your stable, dog at your front door, and all that dwells within your gates, we wish you 10 times more. A soul, a soul, a soul cake. Please get Mrs. a soul cake. Apple, a pear, plum, a cherry. Any good thing to make us all merry. One for Peter, two for Paul, three for him who made us all. To the cellar, see what you can find. If the barrels are not empty, we hope you will be kind. We hope you will be kind with your apple and straw bear. For there'll come no more soul in till this time next year. Soul, soul, soul cake. Please get Mrs. a soul cake. Apple, a pear, a plum, a cherry. Any good thing to make us all merry. One for Peter, two for Paul, three for him who made us all. The streets are very dirty, my shoes are very thin. I have a little pocket to put a penny in. If you haven't got a penny, a halfpenny will do. If you haven't got a halfpenny, God bless you. Now to the Lord sing praises, all you within this place, and with true love and brotherhood, each other now embrace. The holy tide of Christmas, comfort and joy, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Brotherhood, each other now embrace. This holy tide of Christmas, of beauty and of grace, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy.
This is Silent Night. This is a direct translation into English. It's translated by Betta Klein, nice German name, B-E-T-T-I-N-A, Bettina Klein. Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon godly tender pair, holy infant with curly hair, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace. Silent night, holy night, Son of God, love's pure light, radiant beams from thy holy face, with the dawn of redeeming grace, Jesus, Lord, at thy birth, Jesus, Lord, at thy birth. Silent night, holy night, brought the world's gracious light down from heaven's golden height, comes to us the glorious sight. Jesus as one of mankind, Jesus as one of mankind. Silent night, holy night, by his love, by his might, God our Father has us graced, as a brother gently embraced. Jesus, all nations on earth, Jesus, all nations on earth. Silent night, holy night, long ago, minding our plight, God the world from misery freed. In the dark age of our fathers decreed, all the world redeemed, all the world redeemed. Silent night, holy night, shepherds first saw the sight of angels singing hallelujah, calling clearly near and far, Christ the Savior is born, Christ the Savior is born. Six verses. The direct translation into English by Bettina Klein. Supposedly was written, the tune was written by King Henry VIII. But this is William Chatterton Dix, version of Greensleeves.
What child is this who laid to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch are keeping? This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the son of Mary. Why lies he in such mean estate, where ox and ass are feeding? Good Christian, fear for sinners here, the silent word is pleading. Nails, spear shall pierce him through, the cross be borne for me, for you. Hail, hail the Lord made flesh, the Son of Mary. Hail, hail the Word made flesh, the babe, the Son of Mary. Bring him incense, gold and myrrh, come rich and poor to own him, the King of Kings salvation brings, let loving hearts enthrone him. This race, raise the song on high, the shepherd sings a lullaby. Joy, joy for Christ is born, the babe, the son of Mary. The babe, the son of Mary.
Okay, this is, okay, just so you know the background of this song. Words and Music by Paul Stuckey, Peter, Paul, and Mary, that Paul Stuckey. He called it Noel. Need to look up the word Noel and get the history of it, because I'm not sure exactly. I need to ask Siri, she could probably tell me. But Noel is something to say like, good wishes to you, I think.
It's a greeting.
Yeah, it's a greeting. But it, you know, there's the song Noel, Noel. And this one, at the very end of it, I repeat the word Noel. It says two times, but I do it three times. And Paul Stuckey became a Christian. And I met him in, let's see, 72 when they just got back from England. I'm from Europe. They'd been gone for about 5 years or something. And they did a concert at Constitution Hall. Seats 15,000 people. When I heard that, I said, I'm going to be there because I like the Peter Paul and Mary stuff. I mean, they went from beatniks to country, to folk music and stuff. And they're just good stuff, great harmony. But Paul became, he was the first one to become a Christian. And Peter later did too. Mary never did that we know of. I mean, no for sure stuff. This is a Noel by Paul Stuckey. Up. Okay. Came to pass on Christmas evening while all the doors were shuttered tight, outside standing a lonely boy child, cold and shivering in the night. And on the street, every window save but one was gleaming bright. And to this window walked the boy child, peeking in soft candlelight. Looked at turkeys, ducks and geese, and cherry pies, but through this window saw a gray-haired lady, table bare, with tears in her eyes. Into his overcoat boy child, knowing well there was little there, took from his pocket his own Christmas dinner, a bit of cheese, some bread to share. His outstretched hand held the food, and they trembled as the door opened wide. Said he, would you share with me Christmas dinner? Gently said she, come inside. The gray-haired lady brought forth to the table glasses too, her last drop of wine. Said she, here's a toast to everyone's Christmas, and especially
yours and mine. It came to pass on that Christmas evening, while all the doors were shut tight, that in that town the happiest Christmas was shared by candlelight.
That last verse, they came out with it later, and I thought this turns it into a Christmas song. The weird thing, it sounds like they're going caroling. It sounds like they're knocking on doors and going caroling. People offer them apple cider and stuff. It's Halloween. That's what I found out. Halloween? That's a Halloween song? But this one turned it into a Christmas song.
A true Halloween song.
Yeah. That's what I looked up and heard that it was originally. They didn't. I guess they did write it. Paul Stuckey, yeah, Paul Stuckey and Tracy Batiste and Elena Mazzetti.
I'm saying fun writing this stuff.
Yeah, well, they like to harmonize. Peter actually lived up in New Hampshire, I think, and he set up a studio at his house and just records and plays and has fun. And I heard Peter say one time that he said, this is weird, you know, he said, I've been singing a long time, and now I look in the mirror and I'm an old bald-headed Jewish guy with a big nose, and it's happened to me, you know, like age goes on. Well, he came to Mountain View, and since I had met him that time, and my youngest daughter was with me, Jessica. And I said, hey, you want to go up and meet him? I'll introduce you. You know, acting like I know him. Anyway, and he was very gracious. I mean, he acted like he knew me too. But anyway, I said, let's go get his autograph for you. So he did. He wrote a little autograph for her and wrote one to me. He says, it's so good to see you again, my old friend. And drew a little peace sign. And I thought, That's nice of him to do that, because I know good and well he didn't remember me. I mean, I may have told him about that ride back, but I don't think that impressed him that much. But
nice.
Right here in Mountain View, right up on the front stage. He was here, though, because his daughter got married, and his daughter and son-in-law were singing together. Of course, with him, it's kind of like, hey, everybody wants to come, because he was there backing them up, singing with them and stuff. But I don't know. I don't remember his daughter's name, probably Mary. I think he had two. I think he had two daughters. I may be wrong. But anyway, that is here in Mountain View, you know, up on the stage at the courthouse. So it's kind of fun.
Sounds like a lot of fun. I'm going to start.
You've been listening to KWMV 88.5 FM Mountain View, where we preserve and present the music of Mountain View and the Ozarks. We're going to end this session with Leland Whirl, as he does a very well-known traditional Christmas song, Mary, Did You Know? Thank you.
that your baby boy would someday walk on water. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This sleeping child you're holding will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? And when you've kissed your little baby, then you've kissed the face of God. Blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the mute will sing praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy was heaven's perfect lamb? This sleeping child you're holding is the great I Am.
Well, you've been listening to a special Jimmy Driftwood Christmas Card Folk Music Rewind with Leland Whirl and the Folk Wave, and a little bit of great traditional old Christmas tunes and talking about them. And now we're going to continue with the show, and well, we're going to step into the studio with Alex Prince and Dwayne Porterfield at the McSpadden Dulcimer Studio for KWMV 88.5 and listen to some great Christmas music. So let's go ahead and rewind and get started with the final Jimmy Driftwood Christmas Card Special Folk Music Rewind. All right, I'm Al Timberlane, and you're listening to KWMV 88.5 FM Mountain View. And we're sitting here, sorry, I have to start over. We're sitting here with Alex and Prince and Dwayne Porterfield, and this is for the show on Monday. All right, so let's go ahead and we missed Jolly Old St. Nicholas. Do you guys remember that one, though? That's a pretty good tune. And what are you going to do now?
So what, you were off the air there for a minute?
No, I was on the air. I was not recording. So they don't know anything out there on the radio land what just happened.
Okay, good.
Wow, they must be... have a cold or something.
Hey, we got customers. Look.
A long time ago in a far, far away place.
Yes.
But Christmas time was a coming. It's a over 2,000 year old tradition, so it's been around for a while.
Yeah.
A
long yes.
Time. So.
Indeed. So, does anybody have a Christmas memory that they could? I should have. Yes. Dwayne always. Yes, you do. Right?
I do. Well, back when, when I was a kid. We would come down here. My grandparents lived in Izzard County. And Dad would get off work at like 3:30 in the afternoon. And then Mom would have the car all packed up and ready to leave. And we would take off. And back then, you know, you didn't have all the interstates and everything. It'd take us about 8 hours to get down here. So we would get here about midnight and... I remember coming down the big hill. It turned to gravel right at the top of the hill, and that would wake us up, you know. And then my grandma would be sitting on the sofa, and you could see her through the window, and she'd have her arm around on the back of the sofa watching for us to come in. And you know, it was kind of cool. Of course, they'd be up anyway because, you know, they were watching wrestling on, on TV. So, but anyway, and then we'd go in there, and the house would always, they had a wood-burning stove, so it'd smell like the burnt wood, and then my grandpa would go out, and he would have a Christmas tree. Of course, they didn't have any vendors selling Christmas trees, so he would go out into the woods, and usually, you know, we were used to the city, and we'd have all these fir trees and pine trees and this and that, and he would have a little juniper, a little cedar tree, you know, and they'd have it all decorated up. And anyway, I this time of year I always go back to that kind of.
Well, yeah, we burn wood now, so I can feel that part of it.
Yeah.
And also when it's freezing cold.
Yeah, and it's once you get warm with a wood fire, it's hard to go back to propane or gas. It just doesn't feel as warm, you know.
So a little Charlie Brown tree type cedar.
You know, and we do have, that's funny you mentioned that, because I've always been considered a kind of a Grinch around this time of year. And
No way.
Yeah. Can't believe it or not.
Who would have thought that?
And then,
no way. Hush, no way.
I have my reasons. But anyway, So, yeah, two people over the years have bought me those little Charlie Brown Christmas trees. With the
yeah. So you got two trees right now?
I have two, but I forgot where they are. They're somewhere.
Somebody's enjoying them.
They're there. Anyway.
How about you, Alex? Do you remember last year's Christmas? I'll make it easy. No, you can talk about any Christmas you want.
Oh, just growing up with my family. On both sides of my family, I have several cousins that are about the same age as me. So just waking up Christmas morning and going to spend time with family and just having lots of fun with family.
Lots of fun with family. Did any of you read the Christmas story or anything like that? Did any of those kind of traditions?
No, mine didn't really. I didn't. No. What, you mean like night before Christmas or something like that? No.
Well, in all the movies, in every really. Every Hallmark movie.
Yeah. We did watch, you know, after it became popular and was on TV every year, we'd watch A Christmas Story.
Yeah, I remember watching Christmas movies with my brother.
You shoot your eye out, guy.
Yeah.
So
think about this while you do your next song. What's the number one Christmas song, folk tune, in history?
What? In, like, Christmas?
Is this a quiz?
Yeah. Just think about that. Just think. Yeah,
think about
quiz.
What
the... Okay. You're getting points on this. You know, okay. You're either going to get the points or you're not going to get the points.
Well.
It'll go toward your Christmas gift when we get to Santa.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm going to do another instrumental. What do you think?
Yeah, let's hear it.
And then because, well, you were sick like last week. And
I was,
so your voice isn't like totally...
It's not.
...back yet. You're not 100%. You're not. Like 98.7.
I'm not even sure I'm 98.
Anyway, so I'm going to do another, and I think this was just on the air, but it's a different version. So What Child Is This?
Thank you. And we are in the McSpadden Dulcimer Shop studio, so can you tell us a little bit about the instrument you're playing?
Yes, this is a McSpadden Mountain Dulcimer built up the street there on Highway 5. Let's see, I got this one. This is one of about 20-something that I have accumulated over the years. Some of them I have are historic, but this one is more of a modern one. And, yeah, it's all walnut. Playability and the tone of McSpadden Dulcimer is like the best I've ever heard, and it's kind of convenient that it's made right here, and then I get to go up there and play every now and then and help build them. Like I said, this one's made out of walnut. I also have another one over here that actually has a persimmon top. And that was kind of an accident, because we didn't know it was a persimmon wood or something. I don't know. It got shipped in, mixed in with the sycamore, and kind of looks like it. And anyway, got made into a top, and it sounds pretty decent. I'll get it out here in a minute. But
These are absolutely beautiful instruments, and all the different varieties that they can do for you out there is amazing.
Yeah, they started with number one. Lynn McSpadden started with number one back in 1962 in his garage in Forest City. And then in 72, they built here and moved here. And actually, the old factory is now the bunkhouse.
Rental?
Okay. Yeah, that rental place.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, that's the old factory. And they built the new one up in front of that, yeah.
That's awesome. I did not know that.
And some of the guys that were there in 1972, there's a couple of those guys that worked there then that are still there. And so that says something for the brand. They made over 65,000 go all over the world, so...
Yep, I heard the Pulp has one, Clinton has one, I think Hillary Clinton has one. There's a lot of
Cindy Lauper.
Yeah.
Is one of our claims to fame. We just built her a couple that ended up going over with her on her tour over in Australia with Rod Stewart, I believe.
Wow.
And then she actually called the shop here recently. And
did you talk to her on the phone?
I didn't talk to her this time. Now, I talked to her before.
Yeah.
So, I pat myself on the back for that. about a half hour. And, but anyway, she ordered one for Joni Mitchell's birthday. So we just recently...
Happy birthday, Joni.
Joni Mitchell, dulcimer. But, yeah. So it's kind of neat, kind of interesting, and... I love these instruments.
Well, do you guys, what's up next on your roster?
I don't
of
know.
Songs?
We didn't really have an agenda here. What do you got there? Anything?
What do you want to do?
You want to try that one?
Sure.
Or,
We'll wait until we get a big crowd around the window, then we'll do jingle bells.
Yeah, everybody can join in on that. Now, we just worked on this in the back for the first time, so...
Yeah, about 5 minutes ago?
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, when he was, forgot to hit the record button, right. So let's see how it goes.
Trains and little toys.
saw a man dressed in white and red. Little boy, don't you think it's time you were in bed?
Prince just sang, what's the name of that one?
Old Toy Trains.
Old Toy Trains.
It's Roger Miller.
Roger Miller. I love Roger Miller.
Yeah, great. Roger Miller.
He do some. Anyway.
Oh, I was just going to let you go with it. That was great. I was going to invite passers by, but they're passed right by. Hey, so, Alex.
Yes, sir.
Have you thought about what you want for Christmas? Anybody out there listening might, you know, get a hint.
I asked for a Kindle. I love to read a lot. I read probably like 2 to 3 books a week.
You do?
Yes, I'm crazy about it. So I did ask for that.
What, like fiction stuff or real stuff?
It varies a little bit, but I really love mystery books. So yeah. When I was a kid, I was obsessed with Nancy Drew, and I used to save up all my allowance money, and I would get on eBay. My mom would help me get on eBay, and I would buy those hardback books of hers. And I can't remember how old I was by the time I got the whole set, but yeah, I got the whole set. And so, anyway, I like to read books, mystery books specifically. But
you ever thought about writing?
I actually like. I entered a Nancy Drew contest that was to like write like a short novel.
I know some publishers that know some publishers.
Oh, so. Well, that's probably about as far as it got. I entered that contest, and then I had a poem published one time. So, but that's my extent of that.
All right, exciting things are happening here in Mountain View.
Okay,
all right.
That's the third one.
Lots going on.
Just the traffic is heavy for this time of day. I saw one car. Oh, no, two. All right, so that's what you want, a Kindle.
Yes, or books.
Or yeah, books.
That's pretty much what I asked for.
All right. We're not going to ask Dwayne right now. we're going to let you guys go into another song.
They're going
to
be wondering, you know. Everybody try to make a guess about what Dwayne
wants
for
Christmas. Oh, by the way, did you think about what the number one song is? Does anybody know what the number one Christmas song is?
I know what it is this year. It's that Brenda Lee song.
Oh, my word. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer.
No, not this year, though.
I'm talking about all-time number one.
Oh, all-time number one. So.
Yeah. Okay. Do you want to go ahead and cover that song that you just mentioned?
Well, that wasn't on our
list.
Maybe next time. Maybe next time.
Has a very shiny nose. I do the Dean Martin version.
Yes, let's hear it.
There you go. And yeah, we're here in Mountain View. You can alter it a little if you want, you know. It's folk music.
That's right.
It's the music of the people.
Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer had a very shiny nose.
Sing along.
And if you ever saw it, you would even say it glows. All of the other reindeer used to laugh and call him names. You're supposed to go like Pinocchio.
Oh, okay. Hit it again.
reindeer. Okay. All of the other reindeer used to laugh and call him names.
Like Pinocchio.
They never let poor Rudolph join in any reindeer games. Like Monopoly.
Like Monopoly.
Then one foggy Christmas Eve, Santa came to say, with your nose so brightly, won't you guide your sleigh tonight? Then how the reindeer loved him as he shouted out with glee.
Whoopee!
Rudolph the reindeer. Rudolph the red-nosed reindeer. You'll go down in his story.
And that's the number one folk tune. For Christmas throughout the...
Of all time.
Throughout the centuries. No, it's not that old. I've been told who wrote it, but I can't remember now.
No, yeah?
Yeah, somebody. Right, somebody's living off some great royalties off that song.
I bet.
Yeah.
So we switch into... Dulcimer, banjo.
Oh, I could do another... I'll do another dulcimer tune, okay?
All right.
I'm going to get out that dulcimer with the persimmon top.
All right. You already did your Christmas memory, didn't you, Alex?
Yes.
She did. She did the Christmas memory.
Do you have a Christmas memory, Al?
Ooh, good one.
Yeah, I remember when I was... my grandfather was a Quaker preacher at an old church out in the country, and they did wood-burning stoves on each side, and you get the soot on the seats, and you have to go in early. So get up at like 4 o'clock in the morning and go dust those off. And on Christmas, though, on Christmas morning, he would ring the bell, and he let each one of us children like hold onto the rope. And we're like, whoa, it's like a going
and
up
you
into
got
the
to
balcony.
Ring it?
Yeah, we got to ring it on Christmas morning.
Awesome.
Yep. At 6 o'clock a.m. or whatever time it was.
Yeah.
Yep. And then homemade quilts and homemade gloves and, you know, grandma stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I love it.
And a big white Christmas tree, which is different than our regular tree that we had that was green.
Right.
All right, that's it. There's some great ones, the great stories out here, though, like... I'm glad they did this year. They did the Christmas decoration, the festival, the Christmas festival.
Mm-hmm.
And I suggested to them, I said, well, you know, we need to get some kids with shotguns, and they can shoot candy out. They can shoot some candy out of the shotguns, and they said that probably wouldn't fly nowadays. So,
you know...
But it's normal in Mountain View to have shotguns on Christmas, you know.
Absolutely. I mean, well, that's like a rite of passage, isn't it?
Well, and you got to get the mistletoe out of the tree.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That. I mean, how else are you going to do that?
I know. You got to shoot it out. But, reminds me of the first time that we came down here on a Christmas is right after we bought our house in like 03 or something like that. And so we came down, and it just happened to be the night of the Christmas tree lighting. And, you know, we were from the city, Kansas City, you know, and nothing like what goes on here ever happened up there. So we come into town, and there's little kids that are passing out the mistletoe and cookies and hot chocolate that... And, you know, and they'd shot them out of the trees with their 410 shotguns. and then there was a nativity parade. And then they lit the tree. And everybody's singing together. And I turned to my wife. I said, we just walked into a Norman Rockwell painting, you know.
Exactly right.
It's just like, there's nothing like this around here.
It's just like to today. Norman Rockwell. Hi.
That's my mom.
Oh, she's walking by now?
Yeah.
Y'all can come in if you want.
Hi, Mom.
That's Alex Prince's mom. Right out the window. So, yeah, Mountain View's famous for all that. So, what do we have? This is a different dulcimer.
It is. This one's walnut and persimmon. It's got the persimmon top. And it these dulcimers, there's certain ones that are more special to me than others, because this wood all comes from the Ozark region, and so that's kind of neat. You know, we make ones out of redwood and spruce and this and that, but something about that Ozark wood that just kind of, I like it.
Yeah.
So here's one called In the Bleak Midwinter.
I like that song a lot. Didn't hear you practice that one.
Oh yeah, yeah. I might not have back then.
Yeah. But,
in the bleak midwinter.
In the bleak midwinter.
Yeah, we haven't hit that yet. Man, it's been a beautiful winter so far, which kind of scares me for February, when all the ice comes in and everything.
Mm-hmm.
Not looking forward to that. So, I just lost my train of thought. In the bleak midwinter. That's great.
That was a song that one of my dulcimer heroes, Judy Klinkhammer, she used to sing that.
She's an original Rackensacker too, right?
She is. She passed away.
If you go to the Ozark Folk Center, which I know you guys did some stuff out there, and you can talk about that a little bit,
mm-hmm.
You can see photographs and they have the numbers with the people, and you can, she's in there.
The old photographs, yeah.
Yeah.
And, yeah, we play out there occasionally.
We do.
During the season.
What's that stage?
The blacksmith stage.
Blacksmith stage.
It's a fun place to play, too. Usually when the weather's too cold or too hot or, you know, a big storm coming in or something like that, they'll stick us in that white oak, but... Yeah, we prefer to be outside, and it's fun to.
I'm working on
small audiences like that.
Yeah, I'm working on a little film around the Ozark Folk Center, and I have a little bit of it filmed, but there's a lot to go. And I hope to be in there a lot this next season. Which, when does that season start?
Right after Folk Fest, isn't it?
I think so.
Yeah.
That's March?
No, Folk Fest is always the last weekend in April.
April.
Okay, so April and everything kind of takes off.
They may open a little bit before that, I don't know.
But we go from a small population of, what, 2,500? and kind of burst into 10 to 15,000. It just, you know, during those festivals, it really brings in a lot of people.
Yes.
And I think at this thing here, they had over 6,000 people standing along the parade, which is, plus kids and, you know, plus the kids. So there were 6,000 confirmations that they were going to be there. So along with the families.
Wow.
That's up there, over 10,000 people.
For the
parade and the Christmas tree lighting, which we did this year. And they did such a the chamber did such a fantastic job. Yeah?
Yeah.
Fantastic job.
Yeah,
everybody was out there running around.
You were like the
guru. I was out there running around filming.
Weren't you like the parade?
I was on the parade committee for that.
Yeah, making sure that.
Yes. How did you get the, did you convince somebody, like, we need some snow? That was one of my favorite. Did it win anything?
No, we didn't hold a contest this year.
All right, well, next year there's going to be a contest.
Everybody tied.
Everyone did so good.
But so it's going down the road, good and answer. There's two guys, and they're dressed in their military uniforms, and the snow, you know, and they're, I don't know, probably Vietnam, you know, in their 80s maybe. And they're standing there, and all of a sudden there's like snow. I bet it's been a long time since you've had like snow on your uniforms. And they said, "No, we're from Traverse City, Michigan."
Oh,
so they came all the way from Traverse City, Michigan, for this event.
It's a destination.
Mountain View's a great destination. So, does Alex? Do you have another song?
You want to do a Beautiful Star?
Yes.
And I have one request.
What?
From the Ozark. From the Ozark Experience, like one of those songs that y'all did, are you going to be able to cover one of those?
Oh, yeah, we can do that.
Yes, we can do that.
You want to do this?
Yeah.
This one first. Let's see, we got time, don't we?
Yes.
star, the hope of rest for the redeemed, the good and blessed, yonder in glory when the crown is won. Jesus is now the star divine, brighter and brighter he will shine. O beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. O beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine upon us until the glory dawns. Give us a lamp to light the way unto the land of perfect day. O beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on.
That's a beautiful song.
Yeah. Yes, it is.
So, next door is...
Wallace Woodworks.
And,
yes.
And y'all are associated with Wallace Woodworks. And can you tell us a little bit about Wallace Woodworks?
So Wallace Woodworks is my aunt and uncle's store. They've been in business for 26 years, I think, and been on the square for around 20 years. And started out making cedar furniture. They do outdoor furniture, log furniture. And now we've grown, we've recently expanded. So we have one side of our building is all of our home stuff. It's furniture, home decor, bedding. And then the other side is more of a boutique, and we have clothing in there, purses, accessories, t-shirts, things like that.
And that's over on this side, and I think Sam Younger and others used to play pool in there, right?
Yes, it was the old pool hall.
Very cool.
Yes.
And then let us know if you find any cool... I know there's some artwork in there.
Yes,
so there was... So you can stop in for the artwork and look around and get a Christmas gift.
Yeah, there's paintings in there painted by Glenn Orland in 1974.
Wow.
Did you know Glenn? Yes, he used to do all the cowboy songs at the Folk Center, which I thought was so cool because I grew up listening to him do those. And so to see his signature underneath those paintings
That's cool. Awesome.
What would you like to do next? Do another
Alec? Well, let's do that. We can do that little folks tune, and then we can finish up with John.
Okay.
This song's actually by Charlie Daniels, and there's only one line in it that mentions like Christmas, and. So that's the only time you ever hear it that they play it on the radio is during Christmas time.
So it's Christmas song. It mentions Christmas.
Just because it has one line of Christmas, I guess they can't play it at any other time. But anyway, it is appropriate for this time of year.
Yeah.
So anyway.
It also says snowflakes. So
oh yeah,
that
well
helps.
You got that part.
Yes.
Imagine.
It sounded good, though.
Oh,
I mean,
man. You've done that to me a time or two.
I know. Millions of people listening,
yeah.
And here we are playing the wrong key.
That's right.
That's
all the way in New York and Chicago. Hello, New York. Hello, Chicago.
Hello.
Through the eyes of innocence.
It's very Christmassy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Snowflakes and Christmas trees.
That's right.
So maybe you guys have a last. Well, I mean, we don't have the last song, but did we do Jingle Bells?
We haven't done Jingle Bells yet.
We can do that at the very end. We'll go out on Jingle Bells, but do another one.
Yeah, let's do, you said you wanted us to do one that we do in our regular, you know, we've been playing together since, Folk Fest last year we started, kind of again. Yeah, because back in 2018, I think it was, is when we first decided to try singing together. I think we accidentally did it in the... When you worked out at the caverns, right?
We did, yes.
And, she...
What cavern?
Oh.
Blanchard Springs Caverns. Have you ever heard of it?
Yeah, Blanchard Springs Caverns. So there's another great destination.
It's beautiful.
While you're here.
Yeah. Yes. I worked there for several years as a tour guide. And if you haven't been to Mountain View and seen the cave, then you definitely need to go check it out.
Neat place.
Beautiful place.
And Pam Setzer in 2018, they did the In the Cave, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Were
that's
you there?
Yes, I was there, and that's what we did, too.
And we get, I was playing, I can't remember what, if it was Christmas or they did one in during St. Patty's Day, too.
Yeah.
Celtic.
And I was working.
And you started singing at the end.
Yes, I
but,
did.
Well, we want to...
With the crowd.
Yes.
We want to do a shout-out to the Native Americans, too, that opened it up so that we could do something out there at Blanchard Springs. We sure appreciate that. So
anyway, we started back then, and then, you know, COVID and life and everything just shut everything down for a while. So anyway, started kind of singing again. We've been playing with the Mountain View Meeting Place. Christmas place. We appreciate him and that venue over there. And then,
yes.
And then out at the Folk Center and, and different places here and there every once in a while. So, yeah, it's fun. And
we enjoy it.
Yeah, but one of the first tunes that we started singing was this one.
You can come in.
Come on in.
If you want to, we're doing a show. If you want to sit down and listen.
No, we don't want any part.
Thank you for stopping by.
Anyway, so this is one of the first tunes. It's a John Prine tune called Speed of the Sound of Loneliness.
Straight and you come home curly. Sometimes you don't come home at all. What in the world's come over you? What in heaven's name have you done? Broken the speed of the sound of loneliness. You're out there running just to be on the run. Well, I got a heart that burns with the fever, and I got a worried and a jealous mind. How can love that'll last forever get left so far behind? What in the world's come over you? What in heaven's name have you done? You've broken the speed of the sound of loneliness. Out there running just to be on the run. It's a mighty mean and a dreadful sorrow. It's crossed the evil line. How can you ask about tomorrow when we ain't got one word to say? What in the world's come over you? What in heaven's name have you done? You've broken the speed of the sound of loneliness. You're out there running just to be on the run. You're out there running just to be on the run.
Wow, that's fantastic. So that's one that you sang throughout the season?
Yes. I love John Prine so much. He used to come here all the time, to Mountain View.
Yeah.
Yes. Amazing.
So did you meet him and get his autograph and
hang out with him? She opened for him.
I didn't get his autograph, but I did open for him. Does that count? And I have a picture.
Sure.
With him.
Oh well, you know that counts. That counts.
Okay. Yeah, I did do that.
So Dwayne Porterfield and Alex Prince, and they're performing here on Mountain View Live, and this is KWMB. And you just broke out the banjo, so we're always excited when somebody breaks out a banjo.
Are you?
At least around here we are.
It's about time to play that tune there?
Well, first of all, I want to thank Alex Prince and Dwayne Porterfield for coming out here just before Christmas and celebrating that with us. And we're also going to be playing this on Christmas Day.
We are?
Yeah, along with Leland Whirl doing some old classic stuff from the Rack and Sack. Nice. And it's going to make one big show. And well, people can listen to it while they open their presents, I guess.
There you go. Thanks for asking us to do this. This is a lot of
we
fun.
We appreciate it.
Yeah.
And thank you for coming in with a sore throat. My throat's starting to hurt.
Stop it. Okay. I might should apologize to people for coming in with a sore throat.
No, you can't help it. It's all over
the place.
Well,
when they have to listen to this again on Christmas Day, they might be upset.
Don't y'all worry. It's not catchy. If you hear it on the radio, it must be true. It's not catchy. Jingle bells.
The snow in a one-horse open sleigh. Over the fields we go, laughing all the way. Bells and bobtails ring, making spirits bright. What fun it is to ride and sing a sleighing song tonight. Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh. Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh.
Prince, and thank you, Dwayne Porterfield, for being on the show. Thank you.
Thank you, Al.
Thank you, Al.
Well, Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year to everyone from KWMV 88.5 FM radio to you. And thank you for listening to this Jimmy Driftwood Christmas Card Special Folk Music Rewind 2023 Christmas. And now we're going to be heading into 2024. Happy New Year, everyone.